Hello, and today we are with Mr. John Roberts, who is the director of the Golden Triangle Asian Elephant Foundation in Thailand. Good evening to you, John.
Good evening, Stephen. How are you?
Very well, thank you. Now, I'm very happy to talk to you because it's been almost a year since we last did an interview. And in fact, the reason we're doing an interview today is because of something you said yesterday during an expert call, the inaugural expert call with the Mekong Tourism Advisory Group on elephant conservation. You said you were questioning whether the new normal is being forgotten and we're moving back to mass tourism as quickly as we can. But before we get into that, I would very much like to ask you about the year that we've had. And of course, in a few days, it's the Elephant National Elephant Day in Thailand. What do you have planned for that special day?
So we're going to have a ceremony in the Golden up here in Chiang Rai province. We actually have to move our elephant spirit house. So we're going to have a ceremony for that. And then we're going to all come down here into the grassland. And the guests are going to have a small buffet and the elephants are going to have a big buffet. All fairly informal, but luckily, at the moment for us, the hotel, the Anantara Golden Triangle, has some guests, and we're going to just treat them to a little bit to elephant, some elephant life.
Do the local community get involved with that as well?
I think not this year. In previous years, we've invited them in, but this year it's a fairly small affair. It's been a tough year, as you're saying, and our budgets are not the highest at the moment. So usually we'll invite local folks in, and we'll have big buffets and everything else and celebrations.
Now, we know how the COVID has affected the hotels. How has it affected the work you do in terms of elephant conservation and helping elephants?
We have been relatively lucky, or you could say skillful. Very, very early on, very, very early on, we recognized that we were not going to be able to do everything we wanted to do because of the COVID situation, because not even before lockdowns and everything else, we realized that there were going to be fewer and fewer guests around, and that was our main source of donations. So we cut costs as much as we possibly could, but we also took everything online, including as much fundraising as possible online, and that really helped us. We've weathered the storm, I should say. We're still here. We still have all of our projects going. All of the elephants that want to be with us are still with us. We managed to take in three more. All of our projects, our key projects, are ongoing. We've had to ask a lot of our partners to cut costs, but we ourselves have also cut costs. So it's we're fairly well, I would say, but mainly through recognizing early on that there was going to be a new normal. We couldn't rely on the old ways of doing things and then going straight online.
In terms of finding new revenue streams, new fundraising streams, what sort of things have you done to generate more money?
Well, since the 27th of March, and it wasn't just for making money, but since the 27th of March last year, we've been doing live streams almost every day, twice a day. And that was, it really helped people. We've gone into people in lockdown in the early days. They couldn't get out of their houses, and we were able to help them get through lockdown, I like to think. They were very, very, very happy with that. And it, of course, also helped a few people recognize who we are, and there have been some very generous donations come in from that as well. And then a lot of our other regular guests in the hotels, because they haven't been able to travel, have been able to say, okay, well, John, we can't travel, we can't come and see you, but here's the money we would normally have given. And in some cases, they've said, here's the money, because we're actually helping other elephants around Thailand and we're subsidizing 15 vets and all sorts of other things. Here's the money we would have spent traveling on your airfare and everything else, and here's a proportion of that to help look after elephants. So it's been a tough year, but it's been a tough year for everybody. But I think we've come through it far better than we could have, say, this time last year, just when everything was crashing down around our ears. We've come through it better than we could have expected.
Now, of course, hotels have been affected throughout Thailand. One hotel, the Melia Kosam, we recently donated land for a community farm, which is going to be used to feed elephants in Koh Samui. What other things can hotels around Thailand and the region do to help the good work that you do?
That's a good question. I think let people know about our good work is the first thing. If people want to send them towards our Facebook page, GTAEF Helping Elephants, let them also know about the Thai Elephant Alliance. If they happen to be in Chiang Mai, don't contact us. Contact a group called the Thai Elephant Alliance. You can find them by Googling them. And they really are working hard to look after a lot of elephants and a lot of elephant people around Chiang Mai. And they're doing great work as well. We work in teamwork or in tandem, but they would... Yeah, they they would be able to help as well. And if you are in southern Thailand, there's the South Thailand Elephant Foundation that is also a good partner of ours, but you can contact them directly. So if you're in the Golden Triangle, of course, and you want to talk about our work, of course, put them in touch with us. But if not, I can contact me and I can put you in touch with some local people doing, or some people local to you doing great work.
If other hotels, obviously, it's a great thing that what the hotel in Koh Samui has done there. How much does an elephant need to eat per day? And does a small little farm cover that? Are hotels able to do this, or do you need something much more substantial?
I would think for the number of elephants, 3,800 elephants here, you would need something much bigger. If the hotel had generously given that land to me, what I would probably do, and where you could make a difference, is to grow supplemental fodder. So things like the bananas and sugar cane, not too much of it because the elephants can get fat, but I think shared among quite a lot of elephants, it would be quite a good idea to grow those things that the camps themselves can no longer afford to give elephants, and then help the elephants stay strong.
Now, of course, you do work for a hotel company. That's one of your major partners is of course, Anantara Minor Hotels Group. Jungle Bubbles, they just launched just last year. I believe a few guests, you managed to get a few guests in there. How were they received? Are they open at the moment? What's the status of those Jungle Bubbles, please?
Yes, we're totally open and actually full most nights. They are big. Obviously, we were closed during lockdown and for the majority of 2020. But yes, it's they are the big in a world where domestic tourism seems to be very much without wanting to belittle it, Instagram driven. They do offer people some great photo opportunities, and the power of Instagram, which I'm just learning about nowadays. It wasn't something I ever thought much about in the old days. The power of Instagram and the hashtags to get that image out there is massive, and that really has helped, actually, not only help the hotel but help keep us afloat, because people go and spend a night. It's a fantastic experience, by the way. I mean, I have, even having worked with elephants for nearly 20 years, I'd never done anything like it until I got to stay in December last year. Yes, and that really helps drive donations as well. So the timing, you could say, was not perfect, but the timing was perfect as well, because I'm not sure we could have done what we have done this year without those bubbles.
Now, of course, as you say, there's a lot of people in Thailand that would like that experience. Just tell us, what exactly is the jungle bubble? What can people expect when they stay in a jungle bubble?
Well, it's in the middle of one of our free roaming areas. So we have a friendship group of elephants that live in there anyway. And they go in there at night. During the daytime, they're down here in the grassland with a slightly larger area to roam in. And then these are 360 degree or 270 degree, actually, I think, but see-through bubbles with fully furnished, lovely, comfortable bed, lovely mini bar, everything else. There's a toilet that you can't see into or out of course. Nice hot shower, everything you would need. You check in just before sunset. Just after sunset, we bring you down your dinner, which you've pre-ordered. You eat your dinner on the deck. The elephants, the key to it for me as an elephant person is feeding the elephants is totally forbidden. You don't interact with the elephants at all. The elephants do their own thing. They interact with each other. They have their own friendships. And you get to sit there and they totally ignore you while you get to see elephants interact and be elephants. Absolutely great. And then if you're anything like me, you wake up at 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning and see what they're doing. There's elephants sleeping, elephants snoring, all sorts of things going on. So, and then the sun comes up and the jungle lights up around you. And yes, and that happens. You head up to the hotel for breakfast.
Oh, what an experience. What an experience. Are people allowed
you
to stay
come
more
up
than...
and see it. It's an invitation.
It's on the plans. It's on the list there to do, John. It's in the plans. In terms of, you can stay as long as you want. It's not just one night, is it? You could stay a couple of nights in the bubble if you want, correct?
You could stay a couple of nights in the bubble, but at the moment, thankfully, touch wood, the bookings are so good, you have to book a long way in advance to do that.
Brilliant news.
Most people are just with one night, and then they'll go back and stay two or three nights in the Anantara Hotel, which is on the same grounds.
That's right. Yeah, beautiful. Now, let's getting back to where we were yesterday, where we started this interview, the new normal. When COVID started, a lot of people were talking about how it's changed the world, that sustainable tourism, that wildlife was claiming back some of the beaches and what have you. You mentioned this. What did you mean when you said that you're worried about the new normal being forgotten?
Well, I don't think the new normal. The new normal will be the new normal. But I just remember at the beginning of COVID, there was a the one silver lining we could come up with was that it was going to reset our, everybody was saying it'll, I remember the phrase, reset our relationship with nature, that we were going to stop eating wild animals, that we were going to finally, finally sort out climate change, that we were going to realize because of this thing that's shaken the world, that we were going to realize that the business model that we currently have been running as a human race, if you like, the living model, not even business model, of destroying nature, working out of sync with nature, was no longer fit for purpose, which is something that, as a conservationist, a lot of us had been saying for several years, but largely feeling a little bit ignored or being given some, having difficulty in our work, if you like. And this was going to be the big wake-up call that that everybody would get on board with, big business. Everybody would be saying, okay, when this is over, we will treat nature with respect. My worry that I was referring to in that meeting is having living in a hotel and having been at the end of January when the second wave was really hitting Thailand, not, I mean, compared with the rest of the world, not, but second wave had just destroyed our business. And having no guests in the hotel, I could feel, and I had my own, that personal desperation to get guests in the hotel no matter what. And I mean, you couldn't feed your team, you couldn't do all these other things. And we as a hotel here, with the great power of Miner and Anantara behind us, have done better than a lot of other places. So I do worry that destinations and perhaps hotels without the backup of having a large international company behind them may or will just be desperate to get guests in no matter what. And that will mean, and people are desperate to travel. So that will end up, I just worry that that will end up being going back to mass tourism, or even worse, bigger mass tourism, because people need to travel. We all need to get hotels filled. And what I'd like to know, and what I'd like the group we were talking about, which is wildlife tourism, is how we can help avoid that. How we can help, my request or my hope for that group is we can help destinations. Yes, get tourism back. Yes, do it in a way that manages to give everybody a living again, but also not lose the gains that have been made with turtles coming and nesting on beaches and monkeys being seen in tourist areas and dugongs being seen in places they haven't been seen for decades and things like that.
Is it realistic, John? I mean, it's a very admirable desire, it's a very admirable wish, but is it realistic? Because of course, Anantara's hotels aren't tiny, and they have to. A miner wants to fill them up as much as the other hotel companies want to fill their properties. Is it realistic, or what do you think has to be done from a government perspective to protect the environment and have save the environment, but also work with tourism together?
That's why I'm joining that group, because I don't know if it is realistic, to tell the truth. I know and I feel it has to be done somehow, and I know we've talked about it a bit, but quite how we do that, I don't know. I mean, we could insist on higher rates, we could insist on exclusion zones on beaches, all the things that, I mean, I guess the models were in place before. There were suggestions and models and suggestions of what should be done before. The question is how we enforce it and implement it.
In terms of the elephants moving forward, what do you have planned for the elephants if things do start to get back to a semi-normal, as we hope things will sooner rather than later? What do you have planned for the elephants this year?
To be honest, just keeping going. I mean, if we have to take in a few more elephants because camps are closing down, we can do that. If things turn to better for us, I think our focus will be moving out more and more onto the other elephants. Our elephants have done fairly well. We have a large area of land. We had a great wet season with not as much rain as we'd like, but there was natural fodder. As I said earlier, our fundraising hasn't done that badly. There are a lot of elephants who've done a lot worse. So we continue to expand our projects to try and help them. Maybe look after some more vets or increase our subsidies to vet wages. Maybe we're just starting a project with some American partners to send food supplements to lactating mother elephants in Chiang Mai. Maybe start doing things like that. I guess also I have to admit the first thing that I would do is go back to all of our partners who stuck with us through this year and say, okay, you got, first of all, start paying my team fully again, which, and myself, maybe not myself, I'll do myself last, but you know what I mean. And then go to our partners who've cut so many costs but still managed to run their, keep the English teachers in the schools in the Mahout's home village, the guys, the conservation clubs that have been working, driving wild elephants out of crops, our rangers on in Cambodia, all of those people, and start paying them even more again and say, okay, those cuts you've cost, please stop doing that. Please stop taking a hit yourselves. So there's a long way to go before we get even back to, I think, unfortunately, planning what the next big projects will be. It's just getting our own projects back and then possibly expanding the ones that are helping other elephants across Thailand.
Now, if somebody was watching this thinking, I'd like to help and support John's important work in Thailand, why should they? Why should they choose your organisation and the work that you're doing compared to somebody else?
Well, I mean, as I said earlier, there are other great organisations working. I think the one thing that we have that makes us unique is our partnerships with those organisations and the way that they're concentrating, say, the Thai Elephant Alliance is concentrating on food, we're concentrating on vets. So we're working together, we're filling in those niches. The other thing that does make us totally unique is we're working with wild elephants as well and trying to look at the problems with that. So, as I say, I'm happy to recommend other organizations, but we need money too. One thing out of the disaster, if you like, has been the teamwork between the elephant people and the tourism folks and everything else has been very good to watch.
Excellent, John. Well, I have to say thank you very much indeed for your time today. And before we go, can you see any elephants from where you are at the moment? I know a few moments ago you could, but are there any around?
She's disappeared. No. So this is
never mind.
This is the area here. I'm going to having chucking you. This is the area here behind me. This is where the elephants live. And then there's the Ruak River with Myanmar in the background. So I'm giving my interview. This isn't a Zoom background, by the way. This is a pretty nice place to be. And there were some elephants around earlier on, but they've disappeared. I can't show you.
No problem. John, I have to say thank you very much indeed for your time today. And of course, I wish you and everyone at GTAEF the best of luck for the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stephen. And come and visit. I'm allowed to issue an invitation, so do come and visit us sometime and come and see the bubbles for yourself.